First, a quick review of what Bob Plaza told us at the last meeting about audio meters. He told us about PPM meters, which were developed in the mid-30s, have a 4-millisecond response to a step input and a 1 to 2 second fall time. They have a scale that's a set of bars numbered 1 through 7 with 4 dB steps between them. Bar 6 is the normal or the zero. Bob told us about the volume unit meter, or VU meter, which has a 300 millisecond response to a tone burst attack and a similar 300 millisecond fall time. Familiar scale from minus 20 to plus 3, and an alternate B scale if the percentage is shown on the top. Bob didn't really cover the PCM meter, or digital meter, which came in about the 80s. This displays the encoded bits, and so it has to capture the highest waveform level to the accuracy of the converter. It has a longer fall time usually, like the PPM, and the bar graph is usually dB below zero. Meters are wanted to make one radio program sound as loud as the next, prevent overmodulation of AM, avoid magnetic tape saturation, prevent digital clipping. In more detail, there's a signal level that a digital media won't exceed. It flat tops, it clips. And AM radio is really the same. You really want to avoid muting the carrier on an AM transmitter. Not only is there distortion to the listener, but splatter across the entire RF spectrum to other listeners listening on other frequencies. I included a sort of historical footnote on optical recorders for movies, as these have a physical limitation. They can't go beyond a certain level, so they're going to clip. Meters help avoid distortion of media that distorts softly, like magnetic tape saturation, vinyl recording. Elektra recorded 3 dB higher than RCA. Motown made vinyl as hot as they could get away with. 100% modulation of FM is a legal point. Going above 100% sounds just fine as long as the customer's tuner doesn't distort. At the last meeting, it seemed that several people thought that meter zero was the maximum for the media. Let's try it. This is a video demo I made a dozen years ago. The music is a Sheffield CD called My Disc, and it contains a demonstration of dynamic range. Track 69 is full dynamic range. Track 70 is the same music compressed. It also includes track 8, which is a 0 dB full scale sine wave tone. The VU meter is an Argon B scale meter, and I've set it so that the 0 dB full scale on the CD reads at plus 3 on the meter. So that's all the way up. First you're going to see the tone, then two versions of the tune. Watch the meter. There will be a test.
I'm tired of it already.
I think it's pretty good.
I know to be a sine wave, they have to go on forever.
The waveforms are what you'd expect. No surprises here. The sine wave fills all the space, the full dynamics doesn't, and the compressed tries to. Obviously the meter read too low. So here's your test. What did the VU meter read for each segment? Remember that 0 dB full scale was plus 3 on this meter. What was the highest reading you saw on the compressed track, on the last track that played?
100. 95.
I'm sure I saw 100.
I
hit zero once.
I saw zero, which is minus 3 to the full scale. Okay. And what was the highest reading you saw on the full scale track?
About 82.
Well, should be in dB.
80 or so?
Minus 7.
I can't remember what the numbers were. I remember.
-8, which is -5 on the scale of the meter. That's what I saw. Clearly the VU meter reads an average, sort of a nominal value. It doesn't read the highest peak. To use this meter, we need a correction. The correction is called a lead. Leading the meter gives it an advantage. So the engineer is going to pick the lead for his meter that works best for his equipment. Typical VU meter lead values are 9 to 18 dB. Magnetic tape recorders typically have 12 dB of lead. If we had a system that was completely linear like the Green Line, we almost wouldn't need a meter, and we usually call that 24-bit. If we have something like the Red Line, digital or AM radio where we have clipping, we really like to have some kind of meter that tells us where that happens. If we're going to do it with a VU meter, we need some kind of lead. The blue line is rather like tape saturation. And yes, the output does go down after you reach the maximum output. So how do we calibrate a meter to have a useful lead? The argon meter data sheet tells us how to do this. If you apply a maximum permitted signal, like the tape saturation level, you adjust the 100K rheostat to get zero on the scale of the meter. And then when you use it, you short that fixed 18K resistor. The argon data sheet says that's a 10 dB lead. The PPM also reads low. Leads are quoted as 4 to 9 dB. PCM meter does read correctly. It doesn't need a lead. The very first PCM meters looked like VU meters. They had 0 in the middle and plus 18 at the top. It was assumed that there was so much dynamic range in digital media that you could guarantee 18 dB of headroom for your meter lead. Of course, this would work fine in the studio. You could set up your usual 0 VU tone and it would go to 0 on the PCM meter, but the users knew that all that really mattered was the top mark, so they used all the bits. And later the meters came to have just 0 at the top and every number being a minus. That old demo proved that we need some kind of a lead. How would we set the correct lead? We'd play the music and adjust so the meter reads 0 on the loudest parts, and then note the difference between that 0 and the clipping point. I took the CD and this mixing console and Bob's meter plus an average responding taut band meter to measure the higher voltages expected at clipping. In detail, first verify that 0 on the VU PPM meter is plus 4 dBU. I found that for this meter, 0 VU was plus 4.5 dBU and 0 PPM was 3.8 dBU. Not real big differences, but apparently the time constant circuits made a little difference in how it read. Then I was going to play the music track and adjust the music gain so the highest reading on the meter in either VU mode or PPM mode, play the track again and repeat until it's correct for both left and right, that we're reading 0 for the highest point of the music. This is a long, tedious process. The slightest little nudge of the fader might be too much, and this is why this is not a live demo. It just takes too much time to do this. When we finally got the music set, so its maximum is 0, then we play the 0 dB full-scale sine wave, and measure that voltage and compare it to plus 4 to see what our lead ought to be. Watch the meter. There will be a test. First, the meter is set to VU and the music is full dynamic range. Then we play the 0 tone and it goes way up and we have auto ranging on the Heathkit meter. The 0 dB measured plus 14.3 on one channel and 15.6 on the other. So the lead is 10 to 11 dB. Next, the compressed music track on the VU meter. Zero reads 9.5 on one channel and 11.5 on the other, giving a lead around 6 dB. Next, the full dynamics track on the PPM. Zero reads 6.6 on one channel and 7.0 on the other. So the lead is about 3. Next, the compressed music on the PPM. Zero reads 4.4 on one channel and 4.9 on the other. The lead is about 1 dB. So in summary, full dynamics music on the VU is 11 dB. Compressed music on the VU is 7. Full dynamics on the PPM is 3. And compressed music on the PPM is 1. Now, using the meter, you might want to set a larger lead for safety. But was this a good test?
I don't think you had enough dynamic range in your music to protect
the leads. Off. The leads are lower than expected. Reported leads are 9 to 18. We only got 11.
This is also off vinyl, is that right?
It's a CD, but you're onto something. PPM lead was only 3, and they're reported to be 4 to 9. Music was already recorded and metered.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. It was probably a Sheffield analog tape. Yep. That tune from Lincoln, Mallorca was like way back.
Yeah.
So did tape saturation prevent finding a lead over 12?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Also, looking at the left-right balance, it was nearly 0 on the PPM and nearly 2 dB on the VU. Was this introduced in the CD mastering step, watching a PCM meter that corrected it? So if you really want to understand your meter, you're going to have to calibrate it yourself on live music or a known clean recording that's free of clipping and limiting. And you'd like to have a PCM meter with peak hold as your reference.
Yeah.
Very good.
Very good. Why doesn't
anybody use an oscilloscope screen as their meter?
How do you read it?
Well, with persistence, persistent phosphors, you'd see what the peaks were. You could set the fade away.
How do you calibrate it?
Dave, didn't either Mastertone or Masterphonics in New York City have oscilloscopes over every finger?
You don't have the problems of mechanical damping, delay, and all the rest.
Well, you have the PCM meter now.
And that's the studio that Joan Baez made your Diamonds and Rust recording in?
Yeah, but I just don't remember what you're talking about.
Well, when I was there and visited the place, because they did the electroforming of their, when they cut the test pressing and they cut the master and they electroformed it real quick in the next room, they took me on the tour into the studio, and I see these oscilloscopes, 3-inch oscilloscopes over each one of the pots on the mixing console. And they said, oh yeah, we used these when Joan Baez was here when she recorded the Diamonds and Rust album. And so yes, someone did use oscilloscopes, but imagine having like 8 oscilloscope tubes in front of you and try to watch them all. It's a daunting task.
Yeah, Ed talked about trying to watch 2 meters at a concert.
It's really hard to do 2 meters at once.
Mm-hmm. All you need to do is have a peak recording meter that just stays there for a while, gives you half a minute to look at it or something, write down what it was, have more than one of these, and it doesn't move unless it goes to a higher peak. So then you've got the peak sound level. So
if the mechanical meter gets there, and that's why I'm thinking of an electronic meter that sticks there.
Electronic meter, basically
a Bob's meter is an electronic meter.
Yeah.
But it's mimicking the specifications for VUs and PPMs.
The Doro meter is the one that you want, Brian. Doro Electronics makes that. Or they did.
Yeah, yeah.
I think they're still wrong.
Yeah.
But if you have that, what do you got? You got the peak level.
Yeah. What more do you really want? But what do you really need?
It depends what you want to know.
What are you trying to do?
trying to make a recording that that doesn't go into clipping. You maximize the signal and maximize the number of bits without going into clipping.
We use a 24-bit system, then it doesn't really matter too much.
That's right.
If you're recording on tape, you'd like to push the peaks into some nonlinearity in order to get above the noise.
I can understand all kinds of stupid compromises 20 years ago, 30 years ago. We're talking, I'm sort of interested now. What do we do today?
We use a PCM meter that catches everything.
Yeah, right.
That's your sample and hold meter.
Sure.
So,
yeah, but what the point of this discussion is that PPM meters and VU meters aren't even close.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. PPM is kind of sort of close if your music's kind of under control to start with, but VU is a whole different animal. It was meant for volume units, and with a suitable lead, you can use it to keep your AM transmitter from clipping.
Of course, that's like saying we've got currently digital recordings, and in the old days, we had vinyl and moving plastic ribbons that are a whole different animal. I mean, we're talking nonlinearities out the whatever, you know.
Well, that's what this whole thing was about.
So it seemed that people didn't quite know that. So if you're trying to make a meter to work with a totally nonlinear system, okay, I guess you may have to make a nonlinear meter to help.
Well, actually, the meter was just fine, and for the time, it was just fine with magnetic tape. You use a 12 dB lead. You really did well because the tape took care of anything you missed.
Now, how much of this 12 dB lead was incorporated in the guaranteed 1% overshoot business? Was that part and parcel of the same process?
Well, I think you're really stretching it there. The overshoot business had something to do with a physical meter that existed in 1942.
Well,
tape recorder that existed in 1948 used the meter that was already sitting on the shelf. And whether it had some overshoot or not made absolutely no difference because the tape saturation took care of those peaks. They never went above plus 12. And if you went even further up, the signal went down.
So what you're saying is the people who put all these tape recorders on the market didn't bother to upgrade their metering system. They just used what was on the shelf.
Well, actually, it worked so well that they didn't have to.
But you just got finished saying it didn't work at all well.
I think you're trying extremely hard to be difficult.
Well, yeah.
Well, he doesn't have to work at that.
Vern, when we will align tape recorders all the time, align them, we get a tape out that had a nice healthy signal that we could read zero on, and it would read zero at least at 15 inches per second all the way up to 15 or 20 kilohertz, I can't remember.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just real handy, and then you could tell the musicians or tell the recording engineers, don't let it go above zero.
Mm-hmm.
And it all incorporated that.
Yes, there was a cooperation between the engineers who made the machine and the recording engineers who used the machine.
Mm-hmm.
They came to an understanding of what the meter said with regard to the technical capabilities and what the meter said regarding the music. Mm-hmm. And the result was that you could control your music, so it sounded pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Recollection I have when DATTIC first hit the market, bought a TASCAM DAT machine. That's the first time I had a VU meter. Well, it wasn't a VU meter. I thought it was a VU meter that had peak hold and it was all digital, mm-hmm. and it was huge. It was the width of the deck, mm-hmm. and I thought this is really cool. And the reason was, right after that, about 5 years later, the CD recorder came along, and they were $15 a blank. So I was pre-mastering off of vinyl LPs and 45s mostly onto the DAT to get it right. And I really enjoyed the meter because it had fast response, and it had a peak hold that took maybe a second or two to decay, so you could kind of watch where peak level was. And I thought I was getting awfully good recordings that way. And then once I had the DAT ready to go, I speed-iffed over to the recorder, and I wasted a blank to get a good result. And
the neatest thing about taking an existing analog tape over to a digital recording was once you found where that plus 12, that saturation point was, it never moved. Mm-hmm. Once you found the point in your original analog magnetic tape where it was the loudest, there was nothing louder than that. It never could get any louder. Your PCM meter could never find anything louder.
But even to this day, I don't make DAT tapes anymore. The machine's still there. And when I want to make a straight to the computer digital recording, I will still, if I'm going off of especially my old reel-to-reels, or heaven forbid, my old cassettes, the only ones I do on a cassette are the live recordings I made, where they've never been subjected to car heat and damage. And like that meter just was like dying and going to heaven. I can set levels so nice, and then run over into the computer and make WAV files that are pretty decent. Not clipped, not square wave, not down in the mud. And so I've enjoyed this presentation, even though I had to miss it when I went to the John. A little bit. Thank you.
What does PCM stand for?
Pulse Code Modulation.
Pulse Code.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I used that sort of as a shorthand.
PPM.
They're all... No, PPM is an analog meter. PCM.
Well, PCM
is a pulse code
modulation
meter.
PPM is peak program meter.
Yes, and that's the mid-30s German and British meter. PCM is a digital meter, and it wouldn't have to be PCM as long as it read the highest bits. But the simplest implementation of a PCM meter, a digital meter, is takes the PCM bits and puts it on LEDs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is what that is.
Yeah, and again, I never thought I would
there.
Have such a
no.
luxury to have.
No, what is that thing there?
Bob's meter.
Machine there.
Bob's Alpha Electronics VU meter is a replication of mechanical pointer meters.
Oh.
Meets the specifications written for VU meter and the specifications written for a PPM.
And so what you were showing on your video was this machine?
That exact unit.
And the heat kit meter was demonstrating what?
It was there to read the higher voltages of 0 dBFS on the CD. It was reading the same levels, the same signal that's on the Bob's meter.
I thought it lagged a little bit.
The Heathkit meter is a taut band meter. It's extremely slow moving.
Mm.
It has no friction so that its reading is always correct. It never hangs up at any point.
It just gets slow.
But it's very, very slow. It's a long-term average compared to any of the meters we've been talking about. Okay, I think that brings the meeting to a close. After we end the broadcast, Dave Hill has a disc he'd like to play for Name That Tune. So that'll be it.
Thank you.
This program has been a production of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society. Opinions expressed during this program are those of the individual speaking and not necessarily the opinion of the Southeastern Michigan Woofer and Tweeter Marching Society.